Corey.
And I'm Kyra. Welcome to Above the Bar,
where every week we have libations and conversations where we take on current hot topics with a legal twist.
So about 4 or 5 years ago, we passed the bar. So here we are with you guys having legal conversations and sharing some of our favorite cocktails and libations. Typically we do a cocktail, but today we're going to switch it up, do a little wine down Wednesday and feature one of our favorite, most delicious wines.
Well, I really like American wines. Okay, I like all kind of wines, I'm not gonna lie. But I do like American wines, and I like the fact that you have an easy option to go to a vineyard. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you are in the wine country and you want to go to the Copeland Vineyard.
We have a couple here in Texas.
We have vineyards here, but yeah. I'm saying today we're featuring the Copeland wine. We're getting a Merlot from Copeland. And you know, red wine's good for you. Yes. It is good for you. It's good for your heart. Here, it's good for your brain.
That's what I tell myself.
I tell myself this every time.
Yes.
It's good for me. It's like juice. It's like, what's grape? Fruit juice. Mm-hmm. With a kick.
Yeah.
Fruit juice. Conversations with a kick. So, we hope you join us. And don't forget that you can always check us out. Subscribe to our podcast. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. And just send your comments through Instagram or Facebook. Email us. Go to our website. Mm-hmm. We'd love to hear from you. If you want a libation, you want a conversation, we are here for you.
Connect with us. So on Facebook, you can find us at Above the Bar. On Instagram, we're at Above the Bar PC. And I think right now we have a poll going from our show from last week asking people their opinions on open marriage. Are you in an open marriage? Are you not? What are your, you know, views for or against it? So feel free to connect with us under that picture or any of our posts and just let us know what's going on with you, anything you want us to talk about, or like Corey mentioned, any cocktails that you want us to make or feature, or any wines you want us to try for you. Just let us know.
We are volunteers. We're taste testers. And you know, it's funny because last week we were talking about open marriage, not even understanding what might be rolling out. We never know what's coming up because we're just trying to talk about new current stuff. And then sometimes stuff just rolls out on your lap.
It does.
Like, what happened this week? They just kind of bloop.
So speaking of marriage, is that we're not open, but somebody engaged in an open manner. Oh, good old Kevin Hart. Man. He has found himself in the hot seat.
And it's funny because when we first started our podcast, which was, this is our 5th episode, and we were just congratulating him because of his efforts to raise money for Hurricane Harvey. So, kind of like, was he trying to distract you from some other things going on in his personal life, like the new scandal, new videos that have arisen or in alleged scam or trying to bribe him for sex tapes.
Trying to extort him.
Extort him.
So apparently there he received a threat saying that, hey, give me a couple $1 million.
No, it was like 12 million. It wasn't no baby millions. It was the boss millions. Like,
give me some money and I will not expose the sex tape. So extortion is pretty much if you threaten someone to receive something in return, like money. And blackmail is when you have something of someone of a personal matter and you're threatening to expose that to friends, family, public, and it could be damaging to that person's reputation and you want money in return. So he was like, you're not getting any of my money.
No, he thought about it, y'all. Let's be real.
Sure
he was like,
I'm sure he did.
They always say cheaper to keep her.
Yeah, but.
So he probably ran that by as well. He did some private thought.
I'm sure he did. And the issue with the tape is you don't know if it's digital or they have additional copies. Mm-hmm. So even if they give you a copy.
Everybody has a copy.
Exactly. Exactly. So that's what's going on with him. Ironically, I'm going to be honest, I initially thought that it was the female in the tape that leaked it, but she was with her attorney today. I believe her attorney is Lisa Bloom.
Who always gets in the middle of some stuff, man. Does. She has a knack for it.
She just got out of the situation, or not just got out of it, but she just settled the situation with Rob Kardashian and Blac Chyna, so I know she's collecting her coins. But anyway, so they're not suing Kevin Hart, and that's not why she hired Lisa Bloom. She hired her because she is alleging that she's a victim as well, and that she was not the one who is extorting him, and she is not the one who has leaked the video. She was not even aware that they were being recorded, like Kevin Hart wasn't either. So interesting to find out. I don't know if they know who is extorting him. Right now it's anonymous, or that's what they're alleging. They don't know.
I mean, I don't think it's anonymous. I thought he got the police involved. I thought, or the FBI actually.
So the FBI is playing this game where they're not confirming, but they're not denying that there is a case. I know LAPD said that they're not aware of the case, but FBI typically would be the ones to pursue this. In every state, extortion is a felony, but they're not just going to get extortion if they use the phone or a mail to pursue this extortion matter. There could be wire fraud. There was the illegal videotaping, and they're releasing that videotape. So there are a lot of charges that they've racked up under this just, oh, let me try to get some quick money and, you know, record this tape and say, hey, give me money or else. So
I mean, just a whole bunch of issues unfurl because of it, though. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have the criminal charges that could come up that you talked about. Mm-hmm. Because all these things are against the law. You can't just record someone, especially if it's two people in private.
Exactly.
And then take that and try to sell it for money. Mm-hmm. But it's also what happens, and I think the bigger question is, because I think people probably think, like, all the extortion will go away. The people are waiting to see, what is his wife going to do? And since that time, I don't think it was timed at the same time. I think it was probably pre-recorded. But they have videos of his ex-wife saying, hey, we broke up because of his lies and infidelity.
No, so, I think that was pre-recorded.
I definitely think it was pre-recorded, but the timing for the release, whoever had that was I'll press the play on this today. And it wasn't going to be hot before because, but you know what? Let me say this. I saw a video, a picture of him kissing some girl.
In
this
the car?
Was weeks ago, yes.
Yes. So that's a completely separate incident. This is not the same female. This incident that we're referring to for the extortion happened in Las Vegas last month, and the incident with the two females in the car happened in Miami before this incident.
Yeah.
So
it's always a question of the girl in question in the video is a stripper, and so I think people have a natural belief that.
So in her press conference today,
so what did she say?
She said that she is not a stripper.
Oh, she's not a stripper.
No.
What is she?
She's apparently like a up and coming songwriter, singer, actress, model. I'm just gonna
Oh my goodness. That is wonderful.
I'm done.
So happy for her. But look.
Hey.
A lot of people have capitalized Kim Kardashian about, you know, things that have put them in a negative light and used it really to
catapult.
Transition their career, because now people are Googling them and searching them, and they have a name when previously they may not have one. So I'm not even hating. I really am not. Mm-hmm. I mean, I always say this, and this especially applies when it comes to what happens in your marriage when you get a divorce, and especially in states like Texas and California, where it's community property.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's probably a prenup. But what happens when all this happens and there's been adultery, and we talked about adultery last week and what the charges could be. But like when I say it's cheaper to keep her, you know, depending on your situation, it certainly may be, and especially if it pulls up other issues.
Right. Now, I believe, now I'm getting all this from multiple sources, but a source today said that she is not going to divorce him. She's not going to end the marriage. Sources close to her stated that she's still, you know, in love with him. That's her husband, and, you know, she definitely is not happy about the situation, but they're going to work together to move forward. So,
you know what, I've seen a lot of memes. I didn't think
she would leave him.
But we've seen a lot of memes. We've certainly seen Jay-Z being very public about him cheating on Beyonce. And so I've seen memes like, look at all these men who've cheated on these, you know, beautiful, seemingly beautiful relationships, and they've cheated. And so why would you say you're going to leave? But what I don't like is that I feel like women are shamed if they stay.
Yes, and I agree with that, because I felt like it has become a public matter, but I feel like the public opinion makes their healing or whatever decision they're going to
really
make
hard.
That much harder.
Yeah.
Whereas if they could just handle it without having all these other voices
yeah.
and public opinion and paparazzi around every corner, I think it definitely does make it much harder. So I definitely agree, and I wish that we didn't have all this publicity around private affairs. But
when you put yourself
is.
Out there and
right.
you want to make a movie and make millions of dollars per mm-hmm. movie, you kind of, it's the same risk. I think there's a CEO today who just like completely cussed out Kathy Griffin. And he's getting a lot of flack.
I didn't see that.
Yeah, for KB Holmes. And he's
oh,
getting a lot
wow.
of flack because he was calling her every name out of the book. And
wow.
the stock took a plummet. So the point is,
yes.
when you're a private public figure and you have like a responsibility to the community, or people look up to you, or you know, you just want to engage them
mm-hmm.
as a celebrity, where does it stop? Can you just go live your life and say, well, when I'm not doing what I do, when I'm not acting, or when I'm not being a comedian,
yeah.
it's not, I don't have responsibility to the public.
And the reason why not handling me dealing with contracts and then just researching how some of the entertainment industry and how it's
mm-hmm.
going and the trends with contracts, a lot of artists and celebrities, especially Kevin Hart, have specific clauses that say, hey, if you give me a certain amount of money, then I will play the TV show,
mm-hmm.
the movie, the whatever, this much on my social media. So you're engaging people, you're engaging your audience on a more personal level about
yeah.
your business affairs. So when you muddle that, there is no way that you can then draw the line. So if you take a personal hit like this, it's going to reflect in your business ventures and things like that. And that, I don't know how that may affect his contracts that he has currently with different movies and things that he has coming out. Because he was one of the first actors, comedians to have a specific clause saying, hey, if you want me to market and do these things about the movie and this, that, and the other, I need additional amount of money.
And we've seen situations like this that have become explosive and really made people's credibility and
mm-hmm.
you know their how they attract the consumer.
Yeah,
it really takes a plunge.
Yeah.
Look at Tiger Woods, and I mean he lost so many contracts
mm-hmm.
after what happened with his wife. It was just everybody was jumping ship because at the end of the day, the people who are buying you, your celebrity, that's a commodity.
Right.
Exactly.
They
want
exactly.
you to be friendly across these certain audiences that they've already chosen, and perhaps one of his audiences is women because he seems pretty,
mm-hmm.
you know, friendly.
Yeah.
Kevin Hart, funny, haha.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you start and you're cheating and you kind of disengage that
mm-hmm.
that audience, then they're saying, well, you're not worth as much money to me, or we can find someone
right.
else.
Right.
We can find The Rock, who is also funny in this and this
right.
and this.
And
but
female
he doesn't
audience.
Have scandal
mm-hmm.
surrounding him.
Yeah.
So I think that's kind of why Kevin Hart chose on Instagram to release the video, or not to release that video, but to have a
apology.
Little, have his apology
mm-hmm.
and his point of view from what happened and, you know, just not being perfect. And I don't, certainly don't think anybody should be perfect, or that should be what
no.
you aspire
yeah.
to. People make mistakes. Men cheat. Women cheat. It's life. So it's part of it's kind of like grow up. People cheat.
Mm-hmm.
And that's their own relationship. But I always tell people, it is a difference between cheating, oops, something happened, and being a cheater.
Yes.
Where no matter what the situation is, you just... open marriage, whatever
right.
you call it, you just want to live your life. You see something you like, it gets you a little juju going.
Have some wine.
Have some wine. Have some, you know.
Other libations. Or...
libations. You turn up at a strip club and something looks good to you.
Mm-hmm.
You just want to pick an apple from the tree.
Now, the situation, or I've heard conflicting things with this matter. I don't know if it was a ongoing, brief relationship or if it's just a one-time thing. Who knows? I don't know. Apparently, they're no longer together or no longer, you know, involved
in
with each other.
I don't know.
But
no contact.
I would not be surprised if a plot twist, you know, if, because I'm like, okay, if she didn't plant the camera, who in the heck would have known that, hey, they're going back up to the room, let me go plant this camera? You wouldn't have put it at the beginning of the day. The phone would have died. So, if maybe...
If it was an iPhone, it would have died. Maybe if we got a phone, it would have died.
But if, you know, if she's saying that it wasn't her, but if she's in cahoots with somebody else, or if they made this extortion anonymously and used, like, a disguised voice or burner phones or whatever the case, in case later wouldn't get back to them. I don't know. I'm just saying I'm interested to see how this unfolds and who the real culprit may be and who's involved. And
it's so hard nowadays, though, because it may not have been a phone, but there's a lot of video. I mean, there's a lot of ways to record stuff nowadays.
Yeah, that's true. That's
so
true.
It may not have been a phone. It just may have been something
blurry.
I've seen a lot of people just said, you should just deny it. And so it was deny. He was like, that could be anybody. Who is that? That's not me. I mean, nothing that you have to take some things home and it's personal. So there would have been a court of public opinion, and then there has to be the wife who looks at the video and says, oh, that's your ashy elbow, and that's you. I sent you out in that shirt yesterday, and you came home with a shirt on with all stinky lady juice on it. I don't know. I'm just saying. So it's funny. It's funny we're talking about, what is your right? What can you say? What's your commodity?
Mm-hmm.
Especially to your employers. And Kevin Hart, I'm sure he'll be facing that.
Yes.
And although it may not be public, I'm sure some people will say, we're out of this ship. We want a good, clean, wholesome comedian. And if you're not that, we're out. Yeah. But what happens when your job has a clause in it that says you have to act in a certain way or talk in a certain way or say certain things? And I think Jemele Hill with ESPN is experiencing the good, bad, and ugly of what can happen if you voice your personal opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And
on your personal account.
On your personal account.
But
your employer says, hey, that's not in line with the message we're trying to send. Or it violates some company policy, and we don't like it. So with Jemele Hill, she had a tweet about Trump. And saying that she thought he and his whole crew were white supremacists.
And she's entitled to that opinion.
Right.
I mean, just like Miss Texas, shout out to Texas. What's the word I'm going to use? The politically correct. I respected her and appreciated her stance that she took at the pageant in saying the same thing. But the difference was that she got much praise, whereas Ms. Hill has gotten a lot of backlash.
Well, I think, you know, it wasn't a direct comment to Trump, though. With Ms. Texas, she said she thought that he should have instantly condoned white supremacy, or the white supremacists in Charlottesville. When Jemele Hill said, no, he's just, that is him. Right. He embodies that persona, and so does his crew. And she said it on a personal account, but obviously a lot of people who are exposed to her or know her because she's on ESPN, which is a huge outlet for sports, and it really is not on topic to what she talks about.
Right.
So I think probably the issues with her, any contractual employee issues, are more like, hey, you shouldn't be out there talking about what you need to be talking about is these sports. So,
and I'm sure there are some type of employee policy. Nowadays, with the way social media is and how it's so heavily involved in our everyday lives, companies have policies, especially for public figures and news anchors and all this other and whatnot, of what they can and cannot say on social media. So I know to the outside, it may be like, well, she should be able to say what she wants to say. True, but as an employer of a certain company, you sign off on abiding by all of their policies.
Yeah.
And I know as an athlete in college, we had certain social media policies of what we could and could not say on Instagram. Well, we didn't have Instagram then. Facebook. Facebook and whatnot. So I'm sure if I had it as a student athlete, I know for sure that she was under some type of policy and guidelines of what she could and couldn't say.
Well, you know, I think the other thing that's surprising, because I'm sure she was under guidelines, and I'm sure after she said it, after the backlash, because usually that's when it happens, right? Mm-hmm. After everybody says, oh my gosh, that's so horrible, I can't believe she said it, I don't like this show anymore, I'm not watching it ever again. And then there's the backlash and your employer says, hey, you did something naughty.
Right.
But what they say, what they're saying that saved her is that her coworker said, no, we won't replace her.
Yes.
So does that, can you like take a stand? This is like Jerry Maguire, and there's like, who's coming with me? And people are like, me. Or, you know, what right do you have? But I think, and this kind of mends into with Kevin Hart, if you still have the pull, you're saying, really, I haven't disrupted my target audience. Mm-hmm. I haven't really made any changes to what I've promised you in my employee contract I'm going to deliver. Mm-hmm. If you're paying me money to do sports casting and to speak to a certain audience and haven't disrupted that,
right?
What punishment can I have?
Right. In the stands.
Don't do this at your job, though. Don't like.
No.
No. She's like a famous newscaster, sportscaster, and then you come to your job and be like, I hate Bob. And then you say, who's with me? We all talked about him yesterday in the break room, and everybody said he smelled like feet.
But, and then also with that, wondering the rights of her colleagues who said, no, we're not replacing her. Everyone does not have that luxury to tell their boss, no, I'm not doing something.
No.
So I commend them on the courage to say no and be willing to face whatever repercussions they would face. Thankfully that they did not.
Yeah.
But I definitely commend them on that courage. But that is not something that everyone can do at every job. Say, hey, no, I'm not, you know, if an employer tells you to do something that's within the guidelines of your work performance and position, most times you gotta say, if it's not morally wrong, then you have to comply with it.
Or you face the repercussions.
Right.
And, you know, which is up to most jobs are at will, unless you have some sort of contractual right. And even if you do have a contractual right and they mm-hmm. pay you, or a lot of times they have clauses where you can't just go someplace else.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, like, who cares if they pay you if you can't go get another job?
Right.
And you stay with that job. But it's even more curious to me because I think there was a lot in that interaction and her coworkers sticking up for her and what are her rights. But to say that, which is her opinion, she is just a regular citizen at the end of the day. She may be more of a celebrity, but she's just a regular citizen. But the president has a response to it.
She needs to
be. We got a lot of stuff going on in this world. So, you know, it's more like, don't we have bigger fish to fry?
And all the nonsense that he said or that he said about Obama when he was in office. And it's okay for you to say whatever you feel is truth against someone, but when someone speaks against you, you can't handle it and they need to be fired and how dare she and this, that, and the
other. Yeah. And I think Don Lemon said it perfectly. I saw him on TMZ Sports. Mm-hmm. He was just like, well, when our current president was just the person over The Apprentice, exactly. He said a lot about the then president, President Barack Obama. He said he wasn't, I think he called him a racist.
He called him part of, a Muslim. At one point he was trying to say he was a terrorist or he was feeding terrorism.
He certainly said it was leading the birther movement and saying that he was not born here in America.
States,
he was born in Africa. So he said a lot of things that some he agreed were not correct, but mainly, you know, they were his opinion.
Right.
So,
because he
just pretty much pointed out that if he wanted an apology, should he also not go back and apologize for some of the things that were his opinion that he said while he was an employee of NBC?
Why does he deserve an apology? That's what I don't understand.
That's her opinion.
Why?
Because maybe he's saying he's not a white supremacist.
Okay.
In his mind.
And somebody hurt your feelings because they said something that you don't believe about yourself. Get over it. Nobody owes you an apology.
I mean, in the adult world, if you have a job anywhere in the planet, you encounter some employee, coworker, whatever,
mm-hmm.
saying something about you, get online.
Yeah.
That was unfair or not right.
That's
but people say so.
Get over it. If you put yourself in a public eye, which clearly he has, you should expect that. Get over it.
Yeah. So, but it's a lot of pressure when the White House is demanding that you're in trouble for something you said or something you tweeted. That's like, wow, you wake up one morning and like you have like all these tweets and retweets and the president saying you should be reprimanded or ESPN as a company should apologize. I think it's more of a disclaimer thing though, because I think she said that she came out and said, well, that's my personal opinion.
Right, she did.
And you certainly have to clarify what's the opinion or responsibilities of a corporation versus an individual employee of that corporation.
And one difference being that I think it would be a little different if she would have made the comment on the show.
Mm.
That would have had some legal repercussions for ESPN and for that show. But since she did not and said it on her own personal social media, that kind of lessens the blow and kind of gives her a little bit of flexibility in moving forward. And definitely has no ramifications or whatever Trump is trying to say she needs to do.
Do y'all see her eyes getting a workout from this conversation? I feel like I'm about to go, like, do I work out just so I can even get on her level? She got these strong eye muscles. Lord Jesus. Oh, man. So, in lieu of responding to Ms. Hill's tweet, what could our president have been doing? Perhaps preparing for his speech at the UN.
Man, oh, man. So,
I wish we had a video, like a little song. I want to play the Rocket Man. Rocket Man.
Trump. Okay. Let's see. Okay, well, first it started where he said, I talked with President Moon about Rocket Man. Rocket Man referring to the president of North Korea. But that's last week's news. Let's talk about this week's news.
That was just a couple days ago. Oh. You mean when he made the statement or his speech at the UN?
Right, that was the statement. Then at the UN, just yesterday, this man stated that if North Korea does anything, then we will utterly destroy them. That's what he said. So he pretty much just gave them their soundbite of the century to further feed their hatred and animosity towards us.
Like, but where does it come from? Yeah, I think you've taken a love. Where does it come from? Because it's kind of like North Korea, we're a big, giant country.
Yeah.
Why are we at such odds with little North Korea? I don't want to say little. Okay.
No,
much geographically smaller country. Mm-hmm.
So this actually goes all the way back to 1950. It's like, what? So pretty much this goes back to the Korean War, and the Korean War started when North Korea kind of invaded South Korea, and Americans were there because North Korea at the time was still a communist country, and so we were there kind of under UN direction to keep peace, kind of act as like a police peacemaking force. So that's what our history books say. Now, I know how American history books are, so I don't know if that's accurate or not, because in North Korea, their story is that the U.S. invaded North Korea, that's why they invaded South Korea, and that's what sparked the Korean War. So
we don't know what propaganda
started.
I mean, it's some propaganda involved, yeah, probably in both stories.
So yeah.
The truth is in the middle.
But the fact remains that during that war, we utterly destroyed every city in North Korea. There was not a city that was not burned. I believe they stated that within those 3 years, we bombed them, we unleashed more bombs on their land than we did through the entire World War II, just within 3 years, and just on one small, right. Mm-hmm. And so the devastation and having damaged all their cities, and once the war was finished and we won, and so we leave, the Chinese were there, they leave, and now they're left to a demolished infrastructure, they're left to ruins in their land, and that birthed it, and that's what they call the original sin of America, is the destruction to their land. And so that's kind of festered and fed into their constant state of being an emergency state, and their hatred towards us. The current president, Kim Jong-un, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right.
That was good. Better than I would do.
His grandfather was a president, I think like 1943 to 1994, something like that. And his agenda was to ban any American from being able to visit North Korea. And so take that into mind when you're considering the mindset that the current president is coming from for North Korea. He's been kind of taught as a child to have this hatred towards U.S., don't like American citizens. But it's not just him. I was watching something where it was like kindergartners were like drawing cartoon or drawing pictures of American soldiers on fire. So it's kind of instilled in them that Americans are bad, Americans have demolished our land, we're the underdog, we're the survivors, and it is, I think their constitution states that it is their citizens' honor and duty to protect the country and the armed forces. So that allows them to have a high budget when it comes to nuclear weapons. And
but just like or that. Even just service, because there's a lot of countries that have like a mandatory time in the
right.
military service.
Right.
And I believe that North Korea is one of them. But you know what? The twist of that I think is funny. And anytime you talk about war times and how people kind of get riled up, propaganda is a big part of
mm-hmm.
it. And singing a song of whatever, usually it's someone so mean and bad, or someone
right.
stole our jobs and stole our this and stole our that, and we are the only protectors of freedom.
Right. Right.
Sounds
familiar. You know what? They've even said the rhetoric that Trump has stated is so similar to that of North Korea's president. It's just like, are y'all each other's match?
Well, you know what's funny? That's what fear breeds.
Yeah.
So when people are afraid, it gives a breeding ground to things like that,
mm-hmm.
to propaganda, where people
mm-hmm.
are afraid
yes.
and don't have a clear outlet for how things can really improve in their personal lives, or in a way that impacts them, you know?
And North Korea has it, I don't want to say so tough, but in addition to the propaganda that the government is feeding their people, their regulations make it so that they don't really hear anything from the outside world. All they know is what they're being told by their government, how we can freely search the internet, freely watch whatever we want on TV
so
or
you
whatnot.
Think.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have that freedom to do that. And so their news is very structured and tight, even though we just gave them, like I mentioned, the soundbite of the century with what Trump just makes it. He's really just feeding right into what it is that they need.
Especially at a grounds like the UN.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's not just like an American, that's an international. That speech was broadcast throughout the world. And maybe that was his purpose. And I'm not saying that John Kelly was frustrated or not. I really don't know why he's making the faces.
Yeah.
Hey, I make funny faces, and that man was making some funny faces. He need like funny face control, because he was like, no, Jesus. He's looking really funny. I wish somebody
yeah.
would have like a funny sound bite to the faces he was making. Like,
that would be
no.
No. Stella.
That's what he was saying. It's so funny to me. I loved it so much.
Somebody else who was probably making the same faces is President Moon of South Korea. And they feel like they're losing their voice because they didn't know about Trump's previous comments. They didn't know about this comment he made this week. He made the one last week. And then the Secretary of Defense, he made a statement too. And they had no prior knowledge of these things. And so they feel like, hey, chill out. Like, what about our
situation?
Right. What about our country? What about our citizens? What about our people, our land? Because we're right there.
Yeah.
Crazy thing, I did not know that the U.S. and South Korea currently go through military drills together.
Yes.
And they say that it was previously planned and scheduled, and it's not because of current tensions. But then on the low, they also stated, well, it is also to show Kim Jong that, hey, if this is what you're up against if you do want to go forward.
Well, that's a little scary. I'm gonna need to drink on that.
Okay.
We're gonna have to think about that. So, she done drank her whole glass. Is this happened in the course of Above the Bar? She drank her whole libation. It's not
some
me.
Pretty crazy things. The last thing I want to say about this is that we had the opportunity yesterday to. First of all, okay, the UN has banned North Korea from continuing with their military program regarding weapons and whatnot, nuclear weapons. They completely ignore it. So they presented a treaty yesterday to ban nuclear weapons from all countries. Of course, none of the nine countries
none
that
the
have nuclear,
players, yeah.
nuclear weapons signed it, including US, North Korea, Russia, China, Israel, Pakistan, I'm forgetting somebody, but UK, none of those countries signed it. And I understand if one's not going to sign it, then it's like nobody's
yeah.
going to sign it.
Yeah.
So there was that issue. But China, who's not really friend or foe to US, and Russia, who, yeah, you know, they actually they asked for us to stop those military drills. And in return,
wait, no, because Putin was not at the UN. Because
no, this
wasn't
at the UN.
Oh,
this was at a pre. I don't know when they made this request, but no, he wasn't there.
Drill. He was at military drill. That's what he was doing.
Oh.
In the United Nations.
I don't know, because they were trying to say if they don't do the military drills, then they will stop doing, or, okay, U.S. stopped with the drills, and then North Korea, you stopped with the programs around nuclear weapons and all this other stuff, but.
Well, let's say this. War is ugly, so let's choose love, and we love you guys, and we want you guys to join us. Hop in on the conversation. We're giving you all the ways to contact us.
Yes.
If you know us personally, just call us up. Tell us what you want.
Yeah.
We want to talk to you about it, though. And make sure every week, tune in, subscribe, come talk to us above the bar. We love you.
Until next week.
Next week. Cheers.